Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome, a warm welcome to everyone, to the panel, the panelists on this panel discussion on innovation in fintech, which is actually a very hotly debatable topic and also a hotly debating topic in the industry now. Powerful big tech companies such as Google, Facebook, Amazon, and Apple have set the trends in digitalization and innovation in terms of customer engagement and digital offerings to the customers. Inspired by their offerings, the fintech customer groups also have challenged the mainstream players in terms of asking the features and the accessibility in digital today. So in terms of discussing what we are requesting, the traditional fintech players plus the upcoming fintech players, we have an eminent panelist here to help us be enlightened on the questions we have in our minds. So let me first start by introducing our panelist. First, we have Abhijit Ramesh, who is the senior director and leads digital solutions for India and Southeast Asia for Visa International. Welcome, Abhijit. In his role, he is responsible for the development of Visa's product and technology roadmap, Visa's innovation efforts, and leading business development for strategic partnerships. Abhijit's primary areas of responsibility include e-commerce, interpersonal payments, mobile payments, and contactless payments. Over 9 years with Visa, Abhijit had had several positions across functions, including business development, business planning, and financial control. And Abhijit is primarily involved with introducing innovative products in Visa, and we think he's a right fit for the panel today. Abhijit holds MBA International Business from Indian Institute of Foreign Trade and a bachelor's degree in electronic engineering from Mumbai University. Next, we have Yoni, who is a senior innovation coach. So Yoni is ideal fit for fintech companies, for fintech startups, who is looking at inspiration and guidance in terms of starting up or thinking about innovation. He also coaches major financial institutes in their transformation to becoming and working with innovation and innovative fintechs. Yoni is originally from Israel, who is, of course, a global leader in innovation and in fintech in particular. Yoni holds a Bachelor's of Philosophy and Economics from University of Amsterdam. Welcome, Yoni, to the panel. And next, we have Harsha Vanigathunga, who is the Deputy General Manager, IT and Operations, and Project Director at CCAP's LankaClear. As you know, LankaClear is owned by Central Bank of Sri Lanka and all licensed commercial banks operating in Sri Lanka. Harsha has played a pivotal part and a role in changing the landscape of payments in Sri Lanka and has been project director for the national payment switch, which is the common card payment switch, which is branded as Lanka Pay, which all of us currently uses. Before joining Lanka Clear, Harsha was part of Virtuza as manager training and development, and also had stints as a technology officer at JP Morgan Chase, and interestingly, has been a software engineer at Lockheed Martin. So in terms of the panel, we have, I think, the ideal panel to answer all our queries on fintech and fintech innovation. So let me start by asking very simple questions, and progressively we'll get the tougher ones in. First, I would like to ask Ramesh, the fintech innovation and revolution, you know, that we all speak about, if you see in terms of our industry, financial industry, everything is branded as fintech and everything is branded as innovation. Is it just a buzzword or is it really happening? And of course, both these words are closely connected to banking and finance. So with fintech, revolution is banking anybody's business.
Thanks, Suren. I think I'll start off by apologizing to everyone for standing between everyone and lunch. And on behalf of the panel, I think we'll commit to wrapping up a little sooner than we had promised, we had intended to. So Suren, to answer your question, it's certainly not a buzzword. It's a very large trend that we're seeing globally. But it is not to say that it's already fundamentally changing what financial services used to be or what banking used to be. Fintech is essentially a revolution that is being seen on what is called as the experience layer or the engagement layer of a customer relationship that traditional financial services organizations had. It's a way of simplifying the lives of or it's a wave that's sort of driving simplification in the way people carry out commerce, and it's fundamentally driven by a few things. It's the most important being technology, and technology being the driver of access and enablement. Smartphones are an example. Increasingly, people are looking at their smartphones to do everything pretty much, and banking or performing financial actions is one of them. There's a couple of others. The proliferation of social media platforms as a driver of awareness and engagement of consumers. That's another big trend. So fintech is definitely a large trend, but is not yet fundamentally changing what financial services or banking have had to offer. It's just making consumers' life simpler, and it's doing that by primarily leveraging technology.
Yeah, I think also it's definitely not a buzzword. I think it's touching everybody's lives, whether you took a mortgage last week or you came here with a tuk-tuk. It's touching your lives, this revolution. There are, of course, buzzwords within fintech, but maybe we can get critical into that in the duration of the discussion.
Harsha, you want to add?
Yeah, I believe the word innovation is being highly used, whether it's real innovation or not. But I think the digitalization is here, and the winners will be those who create convenience to the general public or the end users. That's my gist of it. So I think the faster we can focus on doing that, collaboratively, I think the faster we will see the fruits of innovation across the board. That's my take on that.
Thank you, Anshan. Since this is this conference is related to disrupt and startups, I'll try to focus on that. Abhijit, first question to you, you know, in terms of business is that, in terms of fintech innovations, we have had properties, products like M-Pesa in Africa, and then WeChat in China, right? Now both these coming from startups and non-traditional environments. So do you think that the next wave or the current wave that you see will be driven by very independent, non-related entities to financial hubs, or the current product suppliers or the current traditional houses, or a hybrid model of these? How do you see that?
So, you know, the two examples that you just took, M-Pesa and in Africa and WeChat in China, there was a certain set of market conditions which led to their proliferation in the manner that it did. But in a very general manner of speaking, we believe very strongly that a lot of the change that fintech will drive will come through collaboration. Visa has been is one of the oldest fintech companies, right? We've been providers of technology to financial services players, the banks, for over 50 years now, and what we have come to realize is the way to drive collaboration is to become more and more open in terms of how people connect to us and work with us. What we have tried to do is go from being a very product-led organization to becoming a platform company. A lot of other technology players have already done that, not necessarily in the financial services space, but companies like Google, Facebook, etc. are examples where they make their underlying capabilities available as services for new players to come and innovate. Google Maps APIs is an example, or any of the services that Facebook provides for people to come and create applications on top of it, or for that matter, companies like Apple, Uber, all of them. We have started doing the same thing. So we said, why can't we position ourselves as a platform company, and we have this developer platform where we invite developers to come and start test our services using sandboxes, etc., that we make available to them. So I think going forward, the real change drivers will be platform companies, and I think the opportunity is for traditional players within the financial services space, again banks primarily, to become a platform for people who are more creative and who are more capable or have the right set of competencies to come and create new consumer experiences or services. If you speak to fintech players today, startups or even mid-sized companies, the biggest challenge to their scale up, they will say, is the availability of a platform to commercialize. They can create the best apps, they can create the best solutions, but when it comes to truly commercializing, for several reasons, regulatory, compliance, scalable technology at times, they need partners who can provide that the platform for commercialization. So a model where traditional players become the platform and new players come and innovate on top of that is what I think will...
What you're saying is that the model will be more in terms of APIs provided by the bigger players?
Yes, so APIs is one way of exposing a service. There are others, but the players who are incumbents becoming a platform and exposing traditional services and allowing experiences to be built on top of those, I think that's the model that will do well. APIs is just one way of exposing those services. There are several others.
Okay. Harsha, obviously, next question is for you. You've been silent for long. This is a critical question, right? What do you think now? It's not like any other industry. If you take social media, if you take retail, it'll obviously govern through a very loosely defined framework, and is also governed by the existing laws, which gets adapted, which gets commercially challenged all the time. When you talk about the financial industry, it's highly regulated. And the entry barriers is pretty high or not seen. You can't, you know, start a bank overnight. I can't print money, you know. So what do you think the role of the regulator is in this fintech revolution? And to what level do you think the regulator is intervening or not intervening here? And does the relaxation of regulations help fintech companies, or is it a gradual process as you see?
Okay, so that's a loaded question. And as I mentioned earlier, or I mentioned the organizers, views shared here will be that of my own and not essentially that of Lanka Clear or Central Bank. But it's a very pertinent question, and it's a question that is very near and dear to my heart, given the new role I'll be playing shortly. So I think... Here's the deal. I think to set the backdrop to this question, I think from a Sri Lankan perspective, because yes, it differs a lot. Firstly, if you look at Sri Lanka, between Visa and Lanka Clear, MasterCard, and all these network payments, the interbank connectivity and those have been set. So Visa has got a brilliant acquiring, Visa and Master and all these guys have got a brilliant acquiring and a card issuing business. Lanka Clear, from a check clearing, electronic fund transfer, real-time payment system, we have got the infrastructure laid out.
Right.
And if you look at most of the banks, thank God for this, their IT systems, core banking, payment, they are very stable. They're robust systems. And if you take the regulator, they have been very... I would say cautious and prudent. So the right ingredients are there, but still we are not seeing the expected return of digitalization. There is much more that should happen, and for this to happen is where your question comes in. So what I believe is this, the competition is not with each other. The real foe is cash, and the real foe is people's mindset. And to do this, whether it's banks or whether it is the fintechs or whether it's the payment networks, all of these guys will have, and the mobile operators, all of them will need to collaborate. And what worked in M-Pesa, I'm pretty confident may not work in Sri Lanka, because Sri Lanka is a highly banked country. And I think in Sri Lanka, it's CASA and cards that are here to stay, at least for the near future. And those being morphed into mobile applications. In terms of central bank, I would believe they're working on it now. They will need any central bank for that matter. If you look at India, they're doing it. If you look at Singapore, they're doing it. If you look at Thailand and all this, are doing it. They'll have to find ways in which fintechs can be brought in into the mainstream. For example, it is with good reason that those rules you said are there for banks, because that is public money and public, and that has to be looked after very judiciously. So banks cannot be frivolous in the way they do stuff. They have to be very cautious. And therefore, central bank also has to be cautious in that sense. But at the same time, you need innovation. And then how do you marry these two? So I'm glad that Visa has done it. I think other big international players also are exposing their services API. And I think banks also should look at doing that shortly so that third-party innovators can actually use it. And if you look at India, they have got only payment banks. And so they have different models, you know, that or different regulations that have been brought in to cater for fintechs. Then if you take countries like Singapore, actually there is a whole department to deal with fintechs, where they will let an idea come in, they'll incubate the idea, they will speak to the banks and see which banks would want to use that service, and they will run it in a sandbox, the usual sandbox that we software engineers know of. Not that, but a sandbox in terms of a real-world sandbox. And once it's tweaked so that it satisfies the requirements, it's put out. So I think the answer is not should a central bank get involved in fintechs and directly work with them. They will have to. If they are to see the digitalization taking place across the country. And the more digitalization that takes place, the economy will grow faster. And end of the day, the way I look at it is, it has to bring convenience to the masses. And it has to create greater inclusion of the all demographics. And finally, it has to come out securely and cheaply. Yes. So that's a kind of a long answer to the question you raised.
Harsham, just a question stemming off that. So if the frameworks are done and the regulation is done, is there a synergy or a vision between these two parties on where to go and where the plan is? So you as a vendor, as a provider, and the regulator, do they see things in common?
So I think... yes, it is. For example, if there are there are a few IT vendors here, there are networks that are here, and they have approached central bank. I know that, not that I have been in person, but so their voice has been heard. But I think that alone won't be enough. I believe that as a country, we will have to be focused on how we can get a greater collaboration between. The regulator, the banks, the fintechs, and you know, so that everybody, see, a bank would specialize in their own role. A fintech will specialize in their role. But to collaborate between these two, there has to be security, there has to be the right ecosystem and environment, which will have to be regulated. I mean, nothing cannot be done without regulation. So I think that's where central bank will have to come in the future to see how these two can be best married so that the general public will be, they'll benefit the most.
Right, thank you, Harsh. Yoni, next question is obviously to you. The fintech companies and the fintech traditions, like we said at the start, it can come through a complete new entity or a traditional powerhouse which is supplying fintech products can come in. Now your specialization area is about somebody who wants to innovate and who is large currently in the market, largest supplying on the fintech area. So if you see the current balance, how would you advise as a start, say, I'm a strong player in the fintech industry now, for example, say, and I'm very traditional. And I see a lot of fintech things happening, and I feel I'm slipping. Where do you think I should start? How do I enter? What would be the advice? Because if you take a traditional technology house or a traditional finance house, there'll be people, there will be traditions, there will be a CIO, you know, there will be a structure in, and we will always resist change. And if there's a huge revolution happening and everybody says there's fintech, there's innovation, what will be your advice? Where do we start? How will you specialize and go in and help this?
So, difficult question. It's definitely a hybrid approach. So, to answer your question, what are the banks feeling at the moment? They are scared shitless. So they're scared of everything that's coming their way from the startups and the innovation bodies. Maybe to first correct a small terminology, when we talk about fintechs, we don't necessarily talk about startups. So there can be fintechs within Visa, within the banks, everywhere. How to embrace this change is, first of all, a cultural transformation within a big organization. So you start with embracing innovation as a state of mind. You start with collaborating with startups. So it's not just about acquiring startups, but also partnering with them. Just to give a concrete example, you know, when you're a startup and you knock on Visa's door, it's not just money you're after, right? It's an enormous client base. If you're in the stage of experimentation, and you give a startup, how many customers does Visa have?
18 million.
Access to 1% of 80 million customers, it's a gold mine for a group of kids in their garage. And for the corporate, there's also a win. So there's also the access to the new technology that they would maybe not be able to develop in-house. So the bottom line, I would say, it's a hybrid transformation.
So what you're saying is a bank can work with a third-party startup or another fintech company and go to market together.
Yeah, absolutely, and we see it happening everywhere, both in acquisition, in partnerships, in adoption of technology. So there is a need. I'm from the very short time that I'm in Sri Lanka, I hear that the banks here are feeling less of a need. Or less of a pressure to innovate. In other words, they're maybe a little bit too comfortable, but that need is coming.
So I think that alludes to what I mentioned earlier. It doesn't need to be one against the other. It could be a collaboration, and the dynamics of the collaboration needs to be understood first, because banks are anywhere in the world highly regulated, and they have to move in a certain way. They cannot move any shape and form they want to. So in that context, and also I think another thing which is more relevant to the audience of this particular conference is that we speak about fintechs, we speak about innovation, we speak about disruption. I don't think we need to look at the sky or the stars right now. Let's look at even small things. I mean, if you listen to Mark Zuckerberg, his speech, graduation speech in Harvard a few months back. He said, had he known that Facebook would have been this big, he may not have actually continued at the beginning, because it would have been mind-boggling for him. So it started off small and it grew. And there are a lot of, I don't want to mention individual names, there are a lot of little things that banks and fintechs have already done. And in fact, Suren, I mean, your company started off like that. At that time, it was a new fintech company, but now you are integrating with banks. So I think the key is, as long as these fintechs, they have a good idea, and they have the right business model, if they could And if they would go the extra mile to actually go, reach out to the banks and speak to the banks, I'm pretty sure the banks also will collaborate with them, because that's the way most of the products that have come out right now in banks have been local companies developing applications, and together with the banks, they have gone and presented it to central bank.
Right.
You have done that, Suren.
Yes.
Presented it to central bank, and then got the central bank approval to implement it.
Yes.
So I think the key is getting that right idea and being tenacious. I mean, if you look at that, even Apple, at the beginning, they had to really make the million-odd calls, not literally, but figuratively, million-odd calls to go and get the market, to get the right sponsors, to get the right thing, you know?
Right.
So I think that's the need of the hour.
Yeah. I was just stemming back from that. I have a question for Amjit. Is that, if you look at Apple, if you look at Facebook, and if you look at a lot of these top tech companies, like I stated at the start, seems to be slowly inching towards payments, slowly, you know, taking over the banking world, which is banking is going to be anybody's business, right? Does it sound that it's the end of the road for the traditional payment companies, so that in another 2 years' time, I search Google with my bank code and some code, and I get my bank balances, and I see my portfolio on the browser?
So, I don't think Google, Apple, Facebook, any of these folks are trying to take over what banks do. What they're really trying to do is logically grow into those segments that help build their core business further. So if you think about Google, right, their primary business is search, and search essentially that yields ad sales and ad revenue for them. And if a small business goes and, you know, buys ad media from Google, Google has visibility into pretty much everything that happens. Who are the people who come and see that ad? Who are the people who click on it? Where they go? All of that through analytics and everything else. But what Google doesn't see today is when that purchase is actually done, whether it happens or not, and how it happens. And to be able to, if you look at it from Google's perspective, to be able to sell that ad better, Google needs to be able to say that, you know, not only will I give you clicks, but I'll also give you a conversion into a sale. And that's the reason why Google, Facebook, and other players are trying to get into commerce, broadly speaking. It's not because they want to. It's not because they want to take on what banks do today. And if you see some of the applications that have been launched, Apple has launched Apple Pay, which is used for payments. Samsung has launched Samsung Pay. Android has Android Pay. Google has Android Pay. All of these do not try to displace what a bank does. They do not attempt to take on the underlying bank account. They only try to create a more seamless way of carrying out a payment using a device. Mm-hmm. And this goes back to my earlier point. It will come down to who creates the best experiences, and whether traditional institutions will survive or not, or you know, will they see some of their revenues getting depleted or diluted or not, will come down to only one thing. It will come down to who is solving real consumer problems, and who starts with. Who starts, you know, their business plans, putting the consumer at the center. Unfortunately, traditional financial institutions have not done that very well. They have typically started with, these are the technology capabilities I have, and with these, I can bring these products to market. They have not started by saying, this is the consumer problem that I would like to solve, or this is a pain point that I would like to solve for. And that will be the difference between. Who will win in the consumer engagement space? Will it be a bank, or will it be a technology player, or will it be a fintech player?
Yes, I agree, because I think the banking industry has been a more product-centric industry than a consumer-centric industry. So the retail tech giants are challenging that. Yoni, just a question, you know, offshooting from that. You coach banks and the traditional financial houses in innovation. and the threat faced by independent fintech companies. Do you think you can wade off those challenges, or are the banks actually seriously under threat from these? Because see, like Amjit, it's finally what the consumer wants as a product, and how comfortable the consumer is in terms of receiving that service or product from that institution. Now, of course, trust plays a greater part in this particular industry than any other industry. So if the trust factor is shared equally between, you know, a solid institute and a fintech, a startup, do you think the banks stand a chance?
Let's try to ask the audience a question. Who's banking here? Who has a bank account? Yeah, I think almost everybody, right?
Everybody has money.
Everybody has money. Who thinks that their bank has their best interest in mind?
Interest is in the mind, yes.
They have interest in mind, that's for sure. But who thinks that their bank has your best interest in mind? Only the Visa guy. So trust is a tricky issue, right? I mean, we all trust the bank with our money, but when you survey people, do you think that the bank has your best interest in mind? They think no. I think the bank is trying to make maximum profit of me. So trust is a very tricky issue, and that's also where I think there is also room for new innovative bodies. Yes, the banks and the big corporates, you have to give them credit. They're not there for nothing. You know, they have a withstanding business. They have a large customer base. They have a lot of buffer to lean on, but they're definitely threatened. They're definitely threatened. And the way for them to overcome this threat is, in my opinion, to embrace innovation. And that doesn't mean to start working like a startup, because startups fail. It means embracing innovation.
And I'm sorry to add to that, that's exactly correct, because if you look at the global trend, even the fintech trend, you will see that fintechs or fintech-based companies are now year-on-year growing about 50% in terms of payment. Year-on-year, they are growing about, the newest entry is insurance. They have grown significantly. So I think putting the customer in the center, seeing how that customer can be served best, and building the products around that will be the key. And so I think one need not be threatened by fintechs, because as long as one could learn the dynamics of collaboration with the right party, and that's the key. Collaborate with the right party to serve your customer, and then you will see even the banks will see the customer base growing, but they will have to work very carefully, because as with anywhere around the world, the regulations are strict, and it's strict for a very good reason. One cannot do away without it. So those are required, but I believe innovation happens in spite of the rigid frameworks being there, because end of the day, we are genuinely trying to serve a customer. There are ways in which you can accomplish those regulations but still provide the required services to the general public.
Yeah. Thank you, Asha.
Sorry, maybe I just add one sentence. If there are any startups in the audience, I completely agree. But don't wait for the regulator.
Exactly.
Don't wait for him. So in 99% of innovations throughout history happened, and then the regulator followed. Okay, first the train was invented, and then we figured out how to manage traffic with a train. Right? First Airbnb was invented, and then we figured out, okay, how does the regulation around hotels and private property figure itself out?
Abdi, I have a question for you. We can't talk about fintech without talking about the mobile, because that's the one that changed, you know, the entire equation for us. In terms of the mobile emerging as the preferred medium of banking now and to the foreseeable future, what are established players like you thinking about the patterns and the trends in mobile? Of course, we have seen things like NFC, various technology platforms coming onto the mobile. But what we have seen with the mobile is the application part seems to be more powerful than the device part. So as a card issuer, payment provider, payment platform, how do you see the mobile being the pivotal medium that you present your services or your platform to the probable fintechs? And what sort of platforms or opportunities do you think that startups should think about when thinking about innovative ideas which can be presented through the mobile? Also, question is a bit long. Is there any gaps that you see from Visa's point of view which has not been explored by innovators or inventors in terms of Mumbai, related to fintech?
So certainly mobile is a significant opportunity. It's sort of the next frontier where you know the commerce sort of war will be won or lost. And just in terms of how big it is, right? It's in Sri Lanka, it's I think about 28-30% smartphone penetration, growing at 40-50% year on year. So almost everyone will have a smartphone in 2 years. One, and second is that it will also, the mobile phone is almost becoming like an extension of the human body. A certain report I was just reading says smartphone users look at their phone as many as 150 times a day. And spend about 3 hours on their phone. That's about, you know, a third of your waking life, right? Waking hours in a day.
Yes.
So it is a very powerful medium. It is going to be an extension of the human body in some ways, and therefore it's inevitable that us or any other business out there needs to start thinking mobile first. In terms of how we are thinking mobile first, there are two things we are doing. We are getting ready for when the Visa card will not manifest itself as plastic anymore, and will have a completely digital presence. And we're doing that through payment solutions that we are bringing to market. So we've recently brought contactless payments on card, but we're getting ready to bring contactless payments on mobile. We are experimenting with QR code based payments, which are again very, very smartphone led. We are looking at how cards can be stored on merchant websites so that consumers don't have to pull it out of their wallet every time and enter it when they have to carry out a payment transaction. So that's one. So we are trying to bring experiences to mobile first. The other thing that we are doing is, as mobiles become you know, all pervasive, we're thinking about how secure it is to store your account credentials or card credentials on a mobile device. Okay. And what we started working towards is an initiative where we are replacing real card credentials wherever they are stored, primarily on devices, mobile devices, and in the future, you know, on appliances and the Internet of Things. So we want to take out the real card credential and replace it with what we call a token that can be used in a very domain-restricted manner, such that if I stored a card on this phone to carry out a payment transaction, if for some reason this phone got hacked and that credential was compromised, and put into another phone, Visa would know and Visa would block that transaction. Okay. And that's a very large initiative that, that we are carrying out, you know, across channels and form factors to say that we do not want real account credentials to be stored on any device or any server or any merchant system. We want to instead replace it with a token that has only limited utility, which then takes the security level within the ecosystem to a much higher higher level and makes it that much more difficult for the system to be compromised.
On card, you all have certain mandates which you enforce in implementation, you know, for Visa and for EMC. For mobile payments, do you have any mandates like that which is coming to come in the near future?
So yes, absolutely.
And just one more. Is there any unified mandate from you, MasterCard, or anyone? My question is it the industry mandate or a Visa mandate?
So we always prefer that there are industry-led standards and requirements. So from a security perspective, you know, the payment card industry, the PCI standards is what we enforce. And from a specification perspective to enable payments, the EMVCo is sort of the standard setting body. We just talked about tokens. The token standards were created by Visa and MasterCard and American Express and handed over to EMVCo. For those who are familiar with e-commerce and how payments are carried out, there is what is called a 3D Secure framework which enables authentication of payments. There's 3D Secure 2.0 that's coming, which is also a standard that Visa developed and handed over to EMVCo to sort of make it available to the industry at large.
So I think this is a little favorable towards the Visa guy and not so favorable towards the central bank or someone working with the central bank. I think
Visa is always working with the central bank.
No, I mean, no. It's actually going to help you with this question. So my thing is in Sri Lanka, this is very localized, I think. In Sri Lanka, we have, in every other country, we'll have the customer, we have the bank, and then we have fintech that's innovating, right? In Sri Lanka, we have the bank, and we have the customer, then we have the fintech. And then we have a little bit of all the government regulations trying to poke into all these things. And I think the reason I put this way is that, for an example, now recently, kind of discouraging e-commerce by increasing all these taxes and whatnot. I think as a consumer, would you want to increase my consumerism through a Visa card, pay it, okay, let's buy what I want to buy? Or do you try to regulate me by increasing taxes on e-commerce and money going outside? The reason why I ask this is simply because, not simply the whole consumer factor here. As a local citizen, I think it's a little unfair how they have the monetary policies in this country that goes into, like, if I want to open a bank account in another country to bring some cash in, I can't do that. So how would you solve that problem?
So good question.
Yeah.
As I told you earlier, I'm speaking independently.
Correct.
And not representing Lankakli or Central Bank.
Yeah.
So my views are exactly that of yours.
Okay.
The increasing taxes on telecommunication, increasing taxes on IT devices, all of that goes against digitalization.
Right.
If you look at countries like South Korea, the way they made acquiring popular was they gave merchants a tax rebate if they on the transactions that were done on their POS machines. And so I think in that sense, yes, there should be that. And I also believe pricing should come down. It's a catch-22, where on one hand, when the transaction volumes are low, banks generally can't give the lowest possible pricing. And when the transaction, and So basically, I think it's the whole idea of having a solid plan. My key word, I have been using this from the time I started this discussion, is collaboration, you know. The fintechs, the central bank, the banks, the payment networks, including Lanka Pay, Visa, and all of them have to collaborate to see how the volumes can be increased. How can a genuine service be thrown out to the customer? So that when volumes increase, the pricing can be brought down. And even e-commerce, we have to figure out a way of having an internet payment gateway. We had to figure out a way of actually software developers and everybody bringing in money from outside, not only being able to spend money, you know. So I think these are genuine problems that need to be addressed as of yesterday, not even tomorrow. So I think, unfortunately, I don't have the answers for it, but I think a greater dialogue, greater collaboration, and greater noise being created.
Just to add to that, do you think that is happening or that discussion is on board?
The discussion is happening, definitely.
Okay.
And the good news is Central Bank is well aware of it. All right. But I think there has to be much more lobbying from the general public to address some of these issues. Taxing is good. We need taxing. But the fact is, taxing the right thing, you know,
correct,
and the right levels, so that the economy will be stimulated and it will not be brought down. Now, when taxes are increased in telecommunication, there'll be a definite impact on people wanting to surface the web, or, you know, and then when you reduce surfacing of the web, there are other issues that come up with it. So I think it's one of those things, you know, chicken and egg kind of situations. So we are running short of time, but very valid. There has to be a much more convenience created in terms of people going digital, but at the same time, prudent regulations. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Hi. My question goes with the next panel, actually. So I think since the banking and all the central banks, guys, people are here. So there's some movement is coming, like blockchain, Bitcoin, and cryptocurrency. So,
yes. How
do you guys think? Is that a something threat to you, like for the Visa or the central bank? So, how do you guys actually try to handle that? So, is that becoming a threat, or you try to make it as an opportunity?
Ramesh, you want to answer that?
So, we are watching that space very closely. There's a lot of uncertainty in terms of how it will evolve. Cryptocurrency, particularly, the underlying distributed ledger blockchain technology has a lot of application, but cryptocurrency is very uncertain how it will evolve. But we don't see it as a threat. We are invested in a company called Chain, which primarily works on blockchain technology. Like every other big technology trend out there, we are looking to find ways of making that work, that in a way that furthers our goal of driving electronic payments. But right now, it's a little early to say which way things will go.
Harsha, how about you think about how the central bank and the government and think about that?
Amazingly, central bank has a lot of discussions around blockchain. But I think when you look at a thing nationally, okay, one would want it to be well understood and well stabilized before rolling it out nationally. So that discussion is definitely going on, because distributed ledgers is something that people are seeing having great value in terms of A, security, B, minimizing settlement risk. I think we need, as a country, we need to change our mindset of looking at something as a risk. Rather, we need to look at it as an opportunity to collaborate or to adapt. Yeah. Because see, if you look at something being a risk, you'll always say him versus I. Yeah. Then we should never have a mentality him versus I. Even like though Lanka Pay would say directly would compete with Visa or Mastercard, I would say it's not the case. We need to collaborate, because the real enemy is A, the cyber criminal, and B, cash, and above all of that, inefficiency. So I think that's the mentality everybody needs to adopt, mentality of collaboration, mentality of creating greater efficiencies in doing a job of work. I think that's the real challenge we have. But yes, central bank, I know for a fact that there have been some discussions going on, and even the deputy governor was once saying we need to look at blockchain. So people are researching into it. So I think we said the same thing. They are also researching into it.
And yeah, I think Harshab, yes, certain countries are aggressively looking. If you talk about Japan, Japan has a huge thing going about blockchains. So in terms of, and US is also, of course, China is also, and Russia is also looking at it. What's happening in cryptocurrency and blockchain is been happening. So I don't think to be fair by the governments, even governments, like we said at the start, has huge responsibility towards the economy and the people and how financial institutes are run. So unless they really know the grips of the technology and the repercussions to a foreseeable future, they will not get involved in it. So even for tech companies, you have cryptocurrency now, you have exchanges, you have blockchain mechanisms going in, certain vendors are bringing parts of it, certain vendors are creating communities for it. But I feel it's a little too early. Of course, as an experimental stage, as a pseudo-commercial entity, you can look at now. But if you're talking about cryptocurrency coming and be dealing with it, you know, tomorrow or next month, is I'm sure Ramesh and the panelists will agree with me, is a little bit early.
Sorry, I know everyone's really hungry.
Keep it short. Yeah.
Quick comment and a question. The comment relates to what Harsh was talking about. To share a development on that, in March we brought down folks from R3, the largest blockchain consortium in the world, and we went and met with Central Bank. And interestingly, R3 invited the CBSL to be a regulator partner onto the consortium even before any banks and all come, because Singapore Monetary Authority, which is the equivalent of the Central Bank, has actually joined in. So I hope that the invitation was out there. CBSL seemed quite open on it. I hope that happens, because that will really be a boost. The question is to both Harsha and to Abhijit. You heard in the earlier session that we won that Colombo International Financial City will have almost an oasis of different regulation to make it more attractive to international players and to circumvent old law, financial laws in this country. For the two of you, if you were to point to two or three things that if there were to be a regulatory sandbox at CIFC, from a fintech perspective, what are those one, two, three things that you'd like to see done?
So the concept of a regulatory sandbox is very appealing. To allow ideas to get incubated and to see whether they can be, you know, brought to fruition and scaled up in a secure manner so that consumer interests are protected. That in itself is a concept which should be sort of promoted. The other thing that we talk about quite a bit with regulators whenever we have the opportunity is the creation of what we call framework-based regulation. As technology evolves, you know, and the way regulation is written cannot beyond a point be too prescriptive. Regulation should be written such that you draw the boundaries of what can and cannot be done, and within that, you know, different participants can come and can create services and products. If you don't do that, what you end up is in a situation where for every new thing that you want to try, you will, you know, be at the regulator's doorstep asking for blessings. And that's from a mindset perspective or an approach perspective, that's change that we would like to see.
And I would concur the same. I think we would need, if we are to do certain things fast, we will need a regulatory sandbox. And it's happening in Singapore. It's happening to a certain degree in China and India also, though they don't call it a regulatory sandbox. They're experimenting with certain things. That way we can move technology fast, move innovation fast, and see if it'll work, what needs to be tweaked, and then the regulation can come out on that. So I think Abhijit mentioned, Yoni mentioned it. First comes the innovation, then would come the regulation, because that's the way we have seen everything coming about. So
it's an innovation-first policy.
Yes.
Right. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you very much for spending time with us and answering all our queries and questions. So with that, we'll break for lunch. I hope the audience had some a good time, and all their queries, or some of their queries at least, about fintechs and the disruption caused by them, was enlightened by our panel. Thank you. Have a pleasant evening.